So we start the last talk of the morning session, and Laszlo Erdős will talk about the edge universality for the non-Hermitian case.
Okay. Thank you very much for the invitation to organizers. Can you hear me? The microphone works. Well, okay, very good. So I'm going to report about some joint work with my PhD student, no, it's the wrong button, Giorgio Cipolloni, and my postdoc, Dominic Schröder. But before I go to that, let me just say one word advertisement about my place. I'm currently at IST Austria, which stands for Institute of Science and Technology. It's a new research institute near Vienna. It was founded a few years ago. It has mathematics, physics, biology, and many other things, computer science as well. But most important, it's a growing institute. It's a growing institute, so we are permanently looking for people coming to us. So consider it as an advertisement. We do have positions for postdocs. We also do have a graduate school, so if anybody is interested in doing PhD, I mean, again, some young people here, then this is a good place to be. So maybe you can check out the webpage. Okay, so that was the advertisement. Now the talk will have two parts. One of them is when I actually talk about the non-Hermitian edge universality, which is the title. And in the second, shorter part, I will talk about an important ingredient to this proof, which itself is interesting and it has a meaning in itself. So let me start a few pictures. So we are looking at random matrices. In this talk, the random matrix X will always be a large n by n matrix. N is a big number, n goes to infinity. But typically, in this talk, it's not a Hermitian matrix. That's the novelty here, also in the title. Most of the random matrix work so far, also in this conference, concerned Hermitian random matrices. Traditionally, one does that first. But then this is about non-Hermitian situation. And we consider the sort of the simplest possible non-Hermitian matrix of that type. This is sort of the analog of the standard Wigner matrices for the Hermitian case. So the matrix elements have expectation zero, and they have IID, independent identical distributed, not necessarily Gaussian. And I normalize the variance to be 1 over n. This is the standard normalization. And under this normalization, the eigenvalues, the spectrum, typically remains order 1 as n goes to infinity. Of course, this is a non-Hermitian situation. So the spectrum is not on the real line anymore. Actually, this is how it looks like. So this is for n equal 50. Under this normalization, the eigenvalues remain essentially confined in the unit disk in the complex plane. And the two pictures here indicate the real and the complex situation, again, similar as in the Wigner setup. You can talk about GUE, GOE, you can talk about complex and real situations. So this picture is the real case, this is the complex case. From far away, there is no difference between the real and the complex case, but if you look at it a bit more carefully, then you see that you see two things on the real spectrum. First of all, it's symmetric to the real axis. This is natural. And also, there are eigenvalues on the real line. Typically, in the complex situation, there are no eigenvalues on the real line. The real line is a one-dimensional submanifold or one-dimensional part of the whole spectrum. There is no reason that there is any point lying on that. But the real is different. A real matrix typically has real eigenvalues, at least a few of them. So actually, the fact is that typically there are square root of n eigenvalues lying on the real line. Okay. Now you can take a little bit and you can increase the n a little bit. This is 500. You still see the feature. This is symmetric. And you see eigenvalues on the real axis. And the other in the picture, in the complex case, this you don't really see. In the complex case, there is no symmetry. Actually, it's more like there's a rotational symmetry in distribution. So it doesn't really matter if you multiply every matrix element of the x by the same complex number of unit length, then the Hoare properties are the same. okay, and this is fine at n equal 2,000 pictures. So the picture is similar to the Wigner case. You, as n goes, as n increases, you see, of course, higher and higher density of eigenvalues, and you also see, of course, the fact that the density, that the spectrum is confined, spectrum is converging to something deterministically. In that case, this is the disk, and also you see that the density. This picture is already convincing. You see that the density is essentially uniform. So unlike in the Wigner situation, the Wigner case, you have the semicircular law, which means that as you get close to the edge, the density decreases as a square root. Here it's not. Here there's a very sharp transition as z, as you go beyond the disk. Up to the disk, inside it's, the density is 1, outside it's 0. So it's a very sharp transition. Of course, also you see, well, this you don't see, but you can guess immediately that that the distribution is uniform, so that means that the typical eigenvalue spacing between the distance between two neighboring eigenvalues is essentially what you expect. This is 1 over square root of n. You have n points in a two-dimensional regime, so typical distance is square root of, 1 over square root of n. Okay, so now, of course, all these things that I said have been already proven. This is called the famous circular law, which establishes the convergence to the uniform distribution of the spectral density of the empirical spectrum on the disk. And also, it has been proven that there's an accumulation of square root of n eigenvalues on the real axis. Now, a bit more formally, you can formulate a local version of this circular law. You see, the circular law naively says that, that you take a subset of this disk, a fixed subset. You count the number of eigenvalues in this subset, and you compare it with the limiting value. That's a typical law of large number theorem. Now you can formulate the same theorem, the same question in the local sense. That's why it's called a local circular law. So that here I didn't have pictures; I have a formula. So the formula is the following. You take a test function f, you rescale the test function, so f is just a nice function, some compactly supported and so on, and you rescale it to a scale of n to the minus a. So a is an exponent here, it will run between 0 and 1 half, and the n to the minus a should be thought of the scale as the scale on which, I'm observing the density. So accordingly, I have to rescale my observable function by a factor of n to the a, and then outside there is a corresponding normalization. And I do all these things around a fixed point z0. Maybe there's a picture later on, so there's no picture. So so I take a point z0, and I zoom out. Maybe I can go back here. So I pick a point z0 here, and I take a little neighborhood of that z0 of size n to the minus a, and I count the number of eigenvalues in that interval. So this is in that domain. So this is that side. Sigmas are the eigenvalues of the matrix, and I take the average, local average of this observable, this localized observable. And the claim is that everything is normalized so, such that, that the typical size of the quantity is order 1. And now, this is a random quantity, and I want to understand what it is. So it, there's a, the claim is that there's a law of large number, meaning that this random quantity with very high probability converges to a deterministic number, which is just the integral of this test function on the corresponding scale. And this holds with a very good, with a high probability, with a good error bound. The error bound has, the, of course, this A appears there. So forget about this psi. This is just a little correction. The important thing is the A here. So the precision of this approximation is, two, is n to the 2a minus 1. So if A is small, for example, A is 0, which corresponds to the global picture, the crudest, most robust resolution, then the speed of convergence in the flow in this law of large number is 1 over n. Very good. If A is increasing, then the speed of convergence, the precision, the law of large number gets worse and worse as n to the 2a minus 1. And eventually, as A, is, A becomes 1 half, then this becomes an order 1 object. So then you are estimating an order 1 object by, with an order 1 precision. But this is natural because once you are down to the scale n to the minus 1 half, so A is 1 half, then the law of large number stops working, because then you are in the situation that you look at such a small zoom, such a small and such a small microscope, then you see a few individual eigenvalues. And once you see a few individual eigenvalues, then you don't have deterministic limit. Then you see that then you should see the distribution, the fluctuation itself. Okay. So this is so the way to interpret is a law of large number type results. And there have been so this is a statement which by now is proven in full generality. It is sort of the history behind that. So the global law which corresponds to A equals zero was due to Gierko. His name will come up later. And then tau would it under very optimal moment conditions, basically just this second moment had to exist. But this was in the global regime, and then the local regime, there have been papers first in the bulk regime, and then the separate paper at the edge regime. The bulk and the edge here refers to the obviously the situation. The bulk is something when the Z0, the reference point is inside, and the edge is when you are exactly at the boundary, and outside it's not interesting. Okay, and then recently we also generalized all these things to a non-constant variance profile. That means that we drop the independent, we drop the identical distribution, and we allow that the matrix elements have a non-trivial variance profile. It changes, the variance changes depending on where you are in the matrix. Okay, now as I already said, for A equal 1/2, there are finitely many eigenvalues which contribute to this sum. Obviously, then we are beyond the law of large number regime, and instead you expect some convergence to some universal distribution. So the right analogy is a CLT central limit theorem type result, and the answer should not be a number, should not be a deterministic number, the limit, but rather a distribution. So now here, of course, the object what we look at is a point process. You have this point zoomed out. So what could the limit of a point process be? The first guess is that it's a Poisson point process that would correspond to the most naive and the simplest situation. But this is not a Poisson process. It has correlations. The eigenvalues, nearby eigenvalues repel each other exactly the same thing as in the exactly in the, as in the Gau, as in the Wigner case. So it's not Poisson, but then what? If it's not Poisson, then what else? Okay, so now here is the corresponding conjecture. That's the Wigner analog of the Wigner-Dyson conjecture, by now theorem, for the non-Hermitian situation. So just let me define you the correlation functions. It's easier to express this in terms of correlation functions also, or the correlation functions that appeared already before in this conference. So here is the one way of defining correlation functions. Is defined in such a way that this is just for any fixed k, the k-point correlation function is a function of k variables here on that side, the pkn. And it can be defined in such a way that if you take any test function f, some nice compactly supported and so on function, and you want to compute the expectation of this test function on k, on all the possible k tuples of eigenvalues, in all possible combination, normalize it properly, then this sum, after expectation, this should be given by, as it's a linear function of f, so it should be given by a function integrating f against some function, and that function is the correlation function. This is one way to define it. So anyway, the k-point correlation function expresses all relations up to kth order in the distribution of the particles. So here's the conjecture, and it's formulated both in the real and the complex situation. The final answer differs a little bit, depending on which symmetric class you are. Here you can even do more general thing. You can even fix different base points. So you fix Z1 through Zk base points. These are in the center of these red dots. And then you take... And then you rescale the correlation function accordingly, so the k-point correlation function is rescaled that each variable is shifted to the corresponding z. So z here is a whole vector, so it's a function of k variables. So you shift it to the vector z, and then you take the variable w, which you rescale accordingly with square root of n. So this is the right scaling, which expresses the fact that you zoom out the picture around the point z, z1, z2, and so on, and you zoom it out on a scale 1 over square root of them. And the claim is that these correlation functions converge in some weak sense against some test function, converge to a universal function, a universal k-point correlation function, which depends on the on the symmetric class, and it also depends on these base points. Okay, yeah. Yes. Because the scaling is determined by the local density, and the density is constant. Yes, it will come immediately, yes. So this just states that there is a universal function, but in the next slide, this universal sum function will be given explicitly. That's the one what you get from Ginibre ensemble. Ginibre in this language is the same as the GUE, GOE, that's the corresponding Gaussian case. So here is this function. That's exactly what you asked. So this is just restating the theorem again, or the conjecture. This is a conjecture still. And then when you ask what this function could be, of course, this function is what you get from the Gaussian calculation. That's called the Ginibre ensemble. Even the Ginibre is not a trivial calculation. It's much harder than the corresponding complex in the corresponding Wigner case. But anyway, there is the function. The function, first of all, is determinantal. It's again given by the kernel function. And here is the kernel function. It's a little bit more complicated. But essentially, the important thing is that, first of all, the kernel function is essentially zero unless the z point, the base points, are the same. So here I formulated the theorem in such a way that that I allowed very different base points, but really, once the base points are far away, then it factorizes in a trivial way. So really, the interesting regime when the base points are on top of each other, that's sort of expressed by this zero here. And also the K kernel itself feels whether you are at the edge or not. So the K kernel is something very simple. It's just basically the e to the Gaussian kernel, e to the minus w1 minus w2 square. There's a little typo here, w2. In case when you are in the bulk, and at the edge it's a bit more complicated than the error function comes in. Yeah, the squares are missing. Yeah, I just noticed that, and also there's some. Yeah, squares are missing everywhere. That's right. It's a Gaussian function. Okay, so this is the formula for the complex case. Now, the formula for the real case, it's much more complicated. It has been found, there's an explicit formula. It has been found quite recently by Burdin and Sinclair. The statement even requires the whole page in the journal, so it's a complicated formula, but it's an explicit formula for the real Ginibre case. Okay, so now here is finally our theorem. So our theorem is to prove this whole thing at the edge. So we consider, so the claim is that the non-Hermitian universality holds in the edge regime, which means that all these base points are chosen near the edge. I mean, here we allow a little bit 1 over square root of n distance, but that's the natural scale anyway. You can think in such a way that the base points are fixed on the boundary of the disk. And the matrix is, of course, as before, so it's an IID random matrix with the usual normalization. We can do both cases, the complex and the real case as well. And the statement is what you expect, so the k-point correlation functions rescaled appropriately converge where they should converge to the Ginibre function given before. And there are some technical assumptions that we need high moments of the moments, every moment of the X matrix elements have to exist. Yeah? Yes, that's right, yes. This is what we prove now, so. Yes. And the Ginibre is, the Ginibre you can do pointwise, that's what you mean. You cannot do that. No, it's a technical thing. Okay, so now, let me emphasize this is at the edge. So the bulk universality is still an open problem. That's probably much harder. Now there's only one previous result about the whole non-Hermitian universality story, and this is due to Tao Wu. They did both at the edge and the bulk, but under their moment matching conditions. So I mean, Tao Wu has this general theory, the four-moment matching, four-moment theorems, or four-moment matching theorems, which basically tell that if you take a random matrix X, not Gaussian, but if you take a random matrix X so that sufficiently many moments match with those of the Gaussian, then the result is correct. So it's in a certain sense, it's a perturbative type result. It's far from being a real universality result. But under these high matching conditions, this has been, both regimes have been proven, but I think this falls short of the full universality. Now, here is a table which sort of, gives you a little bit overview of how various universality results are done, and especially I would like to I put it here to explain why we could do that and how, what is the basic idea behind why one could do edge universality in the non-Hermitian case. So let me explain a little bit the table and let me spend a little time on that because, you know, some of you probably have followed various universality developments and you may find new and new papers coming up in the archive, each of them has a title, Universality of Something, and you may get bored of it. So there is some point behind each universality, that there are differences between them, so this table is supposed to make a distinction between them. But let me just say immediately, if anybody gets offended, this table is just, it doesn't contain all the results, it actually contains only the first relevant paper in each box, and there have been many, many other precursors of these results and later on improvements and so on due to many people, so don't get upset if your name is not on the table. So let me come back to the table. So first of all, here I, the first column shows the various models. The first three models, the Wigner case, corresponds to the Hermitian situation. I'm not going to talk about that, but on the table it has to be put in for comparison. And actually the Hermitian case is the regime which is very well understood. You see almost everything is understood here. The two lower level is the lower lines are the non-Hermitian case, and there is almost nothing is understood. This is one thing. Now the other thing is that of course there's a difference between the bulk, the edge, also we know it in the Wigner situation. And actually, there is a third universality class in the Wigner case that's called the cusp. I will come to that immediately. So there are three different universalities for the universality regimes for the Wigner case. In the non-Hermitian case, there are two. There is a bulk and there is the edge. Okay, so this is about the first column. Now then, what you see in these various columns, these are methods. I'm trying to show you where every column corresponds to a method, a fundamental method, how people proved universality and how people will also try to prove universality in the future, unless you come up with a completely new method, which will come as one more column. So the first method, the simplest method is the moment method. This is when you compute, we have seen it also from Alice's talk, when you start computing high moments of the random matrix, traces of high moments of the random matrix. This is a very, very powerful method for macroscopic scales, for density of states and so on, and to some extent up to mesoscopic scales as well. But typically the moment method stops at some point. It's just not strong enough to go to the very final scale. The only regime when it works is the edge regime in the Wigner case. There's a good reason for that. The moment method can work down to the scale and to the minus 2/3 in the fine scaling, in the eigenvalue scaling, and the edge, the Wigner edge, happens to be n to the minus 2/3. It's a good luck that in the Wigner edge the moment method works. But one doesn't expect any other questions, universality questions, be solved by moment methods. Now the second column is what I already mentioned as the Tauvu method. Tauvu method is a perturbative method. Everything works here if you assume sufficiently many moment matching. So the point is that you want to prove that a matrix with arbitrary distribution is sufficiently close in terms of spectral statistics to the corresponding Gaussian case. Okay, now if you assume sufficiently many moments matching, then you are in a good shape. I mean, it's still a hard work to do, and it's a non-trivial thing, but that's the philosophy behind that. And in each of these papers, they assume exactly as many moments matching so that you remain in the perturbative regime. So this is that column. Then comes these two other columns. And there is a difference between two things. Both columns do some kind of dynamical approach. Dynamical approach means that you start with your original matrix. You embed this matrix into a stochastic flow, typically some kind of Brownian motion, some Ornstein-Uhlenbeck Brownian motion matrix flow. A flow whose initial condition is your matrix. You run the flow, and the end point after a long, long time, the end point of the matrix is the Gaussian matrix. So the Gaussian matrix in many of these situations has the property that this is the equilibrium measure of some stochastic flow. So if you start your stochastic flow with your initial object and you run it up to the end when it's a Gaussian, and if you can control the whole process, and you can control the distribution of the eigenvalues along the whole process, then the result from the Gaussian can be pulled back to what you wanted, the original non-Gaussian situation. So all these last columns use this basic dynamical idea. There's a big difference between the two columns, whether you do it on short time or for long time. So let me say first about the last column, that's a bit easier. In certain situations, you can run this idea up to basically infinite time. So you can start with your matrix, as I said before. You run the flow, the stochastic flow, up to infinite time until you reach the full Gaussian situation. And then that's a long time. And then if you can control the process until this long time, then you're in a good shape. But this is a hard thing to do. I mean, the time goes from zero to infinity, and you have to control each individual eigenvalue. In some cases, this is doable. And typically, it's doable in the edge regime. It has been done in the Wigner edge by Lee and Schnelli, and this is also the basic reason, this is a paper that I'm going to talk about, this is also the basic reason why we could do it in the edge regime, but we couldn't do it in the bulk regime. In the edge regime, there is a density gain. The density is smaller at the edge, and that smaller density means that I can control the evolution, stochastic evolution for a longer time. Now, this sounds like a contradiction because you just asked me what is the density at the edge, and the density at the edge is the same as in the bulk. But here, I will do it not for the original matrix, but I will do it for its hermitized version. And then you will see that in the hermitized version, there's a difference between the density at the edge and the bulk. Okay, so keep in mind that the reason why you can run the Dyson Brownian motion for a long time is that because you are in an edge regime. And finally, this is the hardest, the most sophisticated technology, when you can do this Gaussian, when you can do this flow only for a short time, because simply you cannot control you cannot control it for up to infinite time, but you use a short time. The short time means that you add. You run the Dyson-Brownian motion for a short time. You add a small Gaussian component. This you can still afford by a perturbative method. And then you have to work hard to prove universality for a matrix which has a small Gaussian component. And essentially, there are two ways to do that, depending on whether you're in a complex situation or in general. When you're in a complex situation, there's a magic identity, the Bresan-Hikami identity, or Isikson, Huber, and so on formula, which allows you to do an integral, an explicit integral on the unitary group, that allows you to do lots of things. But this works only in the complex case. So there have been papers which use that. And if you are not in the complex regime, or you want to have a proof which works equally well for the real and the complex case, then you really have to do Dyson-Brownian motion on the level of eigenvalues and all the story behind that. But I'm not going to talk about that because our result avoids that. I just wanted to bring up this table to show you how comes that we prove a universality despite that we are not doing really Dyson-Brownian motion eigenvalues. Because for the non-Hermitian case, doing the Dyson-Brownian motion is very, very hard. Nobody knows that how to do it. The corresponding, the analog of the Dyson-Brownian motion for the eigenvalues of the non-Hermitian case is unknown. It's a big, big open question. Okay. So now let me just put some more names here because, again, this as a disclaimer, this table contained only techniques for universality about Wigner, Hermitian, and non-Hermitian matrices. Of course, there have been many, many more results. I wanted to say that. So there have been many, many more universality results about beta ensembles and sparse matrices and also about eigenvectors. These all could have been put into a table, a separate part, but then it wouldn't have fit the whole thing. Okay. So now let me come to the CASP universality for the Hermitian Wigner type matrix. This is this part, these two parts here, because the CASP is something which is a new phenomenon and it's relevant for our final result. Let me just devote a page on that. So it's a Wigner type matrix. I have to leave the regime of the Wigner matrices simply because the Wigner matrix doesn't have a CASP. The CASP is something, is a CASP behavior at the density, but the Wigner matrix has only a semicircle. There is no CASP there. But if I take a Wigner matrix plus a diagonal matrix, any diagonal matrix, then the density of states becomes something else than the semicircle law. In particular, it can very well happen that the density of states looks like that. I'm just drawing something for you. So a typical density of states may look like that. It has even can have several intervals. It has usual square root singularities. But sometimes when two supporting intervals touch, then there is a CASP singularity here. And this is a new regime. The CASP singularity corresponds to a behavior x to the 1/3, unlike in the square root at the edge. So this is a new regime. So this can be achieved if you tune the parameters properly. It's not a typical situation. Typical matrix doesn't have that, but sometimes if you tune parameters, it has it. Now, how to compute this picture, how to compute the density under this situation? You have to solve the Dyson equation, but this is not a scalar Dyson equation anymore. It's a vector Dyson equation. It looks like that, so you have to solve this nonlinear equation for the unknown vector m. M is a boldface, but it really stands for n different objects. You have to find a solution which is on the upper half plane. And then you take the average of the imaginary parts of these coordinates, and that will become the density of states. It's just Hilthius transform of the density of states. So by inverse Hilthius transform, you can find the density of states. Now, as I said, the picture indicates there are only two types of singularities, square root edge and cubic root CASP. There is no other singularity. The CASP, this is a non-trivial theorem that such an equation has no other singularity. Now, the CASP regime, therefore, constitutes the third and also the last universality regime. So the first two regimes are the bulk regime, the sign kernel. The second one is the edge, that's the Tracy-Widom distribution. And this is the third one. It's a completely different universality regime. The scaling is different. It's n to the minus 3/4. And the corresponding kernel is also a very different one. It's called the Peercy kernel, unlike Wigner-Dyson or Tracy-Widom. This is a third name. Peercy was, by the way, not a mathematician. He was an electrical engineer. And it's known that it's in the complex case is determinant, and there's an explicit formula that's called the Peercy kernel. In the real case, there is no explicit formula known. It must exist, but nobody has found it yet. Now, universality has been proven in the CASP regime in both symmetry classes. So these are recent results, and the complex and the real case was somewhat different. Now, why did I mention that? Because the CASP local law, proving the corresponding local law for this situation, is actually a precursor of the non-Hermitian edge universality if one uses the Gierkos hermitization. So let me explain to you the Gierkos hermitization. This is the bread and butter. This formula is the starting point of any work in non-Hermitian random matrix theory. Gierkos figured it out. This is an identity which expresses for any test function the linear statistics of the non-Hermitian eigenvalue sigma in terms of something which involves only Hermitian information. Namely, you take this, you double the space, So you create this HZ matrix, which is a 2n by 2n matrix. You put the x and x star onto the two off-diagonal blocks, and you subtract a z. Z is a parameter here with respect to which you will have to integrate. So out of one single non-Hermitian matrix, you create a one complex parameter family of Hermitian matrices HZ. But this is Hermitian, so now we are back to the Hermitian world, which we like. And then the formula says that you have to take the trace of the resolvent of this matrix. You have to integrate out the resolvent along the imaginary axis, I times eta, from 0 to infinity on one hand. And you also have to integrate out with respect to the z parameter against the Laplacian of the test function. It's an identity. But the merit of this identity that you can forget about non-Hermitian situation, which anyway is very hard to deal with, you have to understand that side. Okay. Now, in case of the IID situation, the eigenvalue density of this matrix can be computed. It's a little bit more complicated than the semicircle law, but not much more complicated. Behind the semicircle law, there's a quadratic equation, 1 over m equals z plus m. That's the basic equation of the Stieltjes transform from the semicircle law. Here, the corresponding equation is a cubic equation. So m is the Stieltjes transform of the density of states of that matrix. W is the spectral parameter. Eventually, we'll plug W equal I times eta, and z is this parameter. So you see, if z is 0, then this term is not there, and then you get exactly the usual semicircle law, but if z is there, then you have an extra term. So it leads to a cubic equation. Now, the local law also holds. Local law means, in a more general sense, is that the resolvent becomes deterministic, then goes to infinity, and it can be well approximated by a function, by a matrix, which looks like that. The resolvent is, of course, a big matrix, 2n by 2n. It's approximated by a 2n by 2n matrix, which is a block structure. So here, each of the blocks, these are just diagonal blocks. So basically, it consists of four diagonal blocks. And in the diagonal, there sits on one hand this m, which is a solution of this equation. In the off-diagonal, there sits a u, which is an easy formula obtained from the m. So it's explicitly known. The important thing is that it's a cubic object. Now here you see the relation between the two things. The non-Hermitian eigenvalues in terms of the hermitized matrix. So what you see here, this is the spectrum of the Hermitian situation, the non-Hermitian situation. This red dot is the point z, this reference point hz. At the end of the day, we have to integrate over all z. That's what Girkos' formula says. And here what you see is the density of states as a function of z. Actually, it depends only on the absolute value of z. And now as you see that, I cannot stop it. In another version, I could stop it, but here I cannot. Anyway, so when this z is inside, then you start from the semicircle, and as z goes out, the semicircle becomes a cusp. Cusp behavior. And when z is exactly at the boundary, then you have a cusp. So that's the reason why we can do the whole thing. Because if you are on the edge, then after Girkos' formula, corresponds to a cusp regime in the hermitized situation. In the cusp regime, you have this phenomenon, the density is small. The density is essentially vanishing at the cusp, similarly at the edge, as at the edge. And then once your density is small, then you can use then this simpler method following the Dyson-Brownian motion up to infinite time works. That's why we can do this. Okay, so here's the corresponding local law. I already advertised it here. It's written more explicitly. Actually, this was done in much more generality. The pictures, the formulas are just for the IID case, but we can do it something which is called the general inhomogeneous local law. So we don't have to assume IID situation. We can assume that the variances are just order 1 over n, so upper and lower bound. And in that case, the low calorie is exactly what you expect. Typically, there are two types of low calories. There is an isotropic version, the average version. Low calorie is always about comparing the resolvent with this, with a given deterministic object, which you can get from solving the Dyson equation. And then you either test it entry-wise or test it against two deterministic vectors, or you take the trace of that. The trace, of course, has an extra averaging, so the result is stronger there. So the important, so these are the formula is exactly the same what you expect for a typical local low. The important thing is that in the entry-wise local low, the density appears. This is this row, that's the red thing. So if the density, if you are around the cusp, then the density is small. So then the local, the isotropic local low becomes more precise, and that's the reason why one can do the whole thing. Okay, and then here are some remarks about the proof of that, but I don't have much time, so let me jump over. Let me just continue. This is just indicating this is a highly non-trivial thing. The main reason is that this matrix here, I have to use the general theory for this matrix, but this matrix is not flat. There are big zero blocks, and the zero blocks are very bad. So one has to do completely separate analysis to do that. So now here's the one page of the proof, the whole proof once we digested all these things. So we consider an Ornstein-Uhlenbeck flow in this way. So this Ornstein-Uhlenbeck flow is designed in such a way that the variance is constant. It remains 1 over n. So initially at time equals 0 is your original matrix, and at time equal infinity is the Ginibre matrix. Ginibre is what you know. Okay, and now we will try to understand the evolution of the local statistics, in that case this linear statistics from time 0 to infinity. Here I will just write up the formulas for a fixed time, but at the very end of the day I have to integrate all these formulas from time go to 0 to infinity. But this I'm not going to indicate. This is doable. So here's the formula, Gierkow's formula. Gierkow formula has a z integral and an eta integral. Z integral is not so important, the eta integral is important. One splits the eta integral into two parts. The eta integral, that's the spectral parameter in the G, that basically sets the scale. So when eta is large, then the quantity, then this quantity is sensitive to a mesoscopic or even macroscopic statistics of eigenvalues. When eta is small, then it starts asking questions on a small scale. This is how to interpret that. Now, if you run this Dyson-Brownian motion flow, plus use the local low that I had before, then it turns out that you can control the time evolution of this object from time 0 to infinity in the regime where eta 0 is fairly big. Eta 0 n to the minus 5, 6. It's actually quite small, but it's still not the 1 over n scale. So on larger scale, and larger scale here means n to the 5, 6, the local low ideas are sufficient if you use this best possible recent local low. Now, in the regime when eta 0 is much smaller than 1 over n, that's the regime where you don't expect any eigenvalue. Of course, you have to prove it, and you have to come up with some argument with that, and it turns out to be a non-trivial thing. It's about the probability of the small eigenvalues of this hermitized matrix, which is, of course, the same thing as the small singular values of the unhermitized matrix X minus Z. And then there is a theorem of that type. It's a very, very general theorem due to Sankar, Spielmann, and Tang, which excludes small eigenvalues of this type, of matrices of this type. But this theorem is very, very general. It's so general that it has to be somewhat weak. And the weakness is that it excludes eigenvalues on the scale below 1 over n. So this regime is also okay. In that regime, there is nothing contributing there. And finally, there is a gap between the two. There is some trivial estimate below 1 over n works, some non-trivial estimate, non-trivial local works above 5, 6, but still there is something between 1 and 1, 5, 6, and what to do with that. Now, let me mention that if you allow more matching moments, what Tauvu did, then this first thing can be pushed down. Then there is no gap. That's why essentially their method works. And that leads to the second part, which I don't have time because my time is up. So that would be a smoothing inequality for the lowest eigenvalue. So let me just spend 2 minutes to explain the result, and then I will stop. So this is about this famous Sankar-Spearman-Tang result. It's about the singular values of a matrix of the following type. It's very, very general. You take any matrix A0, literally any matrix, and add to that an IID, add to that a Ginibre matrix. This is the only Gaussian result, which smoothens out the matrix A0, and then the result says that the A0 plus X does not have small singular value. So the probability that the smallest singular value, which is the smallest eigenvalue of AA star, is smaller than 1 over n squared with a factor X, is bounded by square root of X. 1 over n squared is the right scale in that situation. It is a very robust bound. Now, actually, this bound is essential it's essentially optimal for the real case, because if A0 is 0 and X is really just the Ginibre situation, then Edelman computed the tail distribution of that, and it looks like that. There's a difference between real and complex case. Also, when you are outside of the spectrum, there is no problem. If A0, which is in our case, A0 is just a constant, Z times identity. If Z is outside of the spectrum, then you know that there is no eigenvalue at all. That's the trivial case. But now we have to do it in the transitional regime. Can we improve this result, which is general, so it cannot be better than it is not sensitive whether you're in the transitional regime? And this is our theorem, which basically says that Edelman is correct, but it says Edelman's result for z equals 0, we need it for any z. So our result is that for the singular values of a Ginibre plus a z, so a shifted Ginibre matrix, and the lowest singular value can be obtained, can be bounded in this way. Now, the most important thing in the bound, the 1 minus z squared, the distance to the original pairs, this is this delta. And especially if delta is 0, which is our real interest, if you are really at the edge, then you see that instead of 1 over n squared, because there's a minimum, 1 over n to the 3 half comes in. That's the right scaling for the singular value at the edge. And then we have these bounds. This is just a picture. So this bound allows you to bridge the gap between these two situations. Still, one has to work, because this result is only for Gaussian, so one has to do an additional Green's function comparison to generalize it to the non-Gaussian situation, and this will complete the edge universality proof. Okay, so I don't want to say anything more about the proof. The proof is actually a supersymmetric technique. I mean, I put in some horrible formulas to scare you away, but I don't expect you to digest it before the lunch. It ends up with some kind of... the key point is the superbozonization formula, which I would like to call your attention to. It's a marvelous identity, and which translates the question into some contour integral, and then you have to do some complicated contour integral analysis, and so on. So that's the summary. So we proved the spectral universality for non-Hermitian random matrices, but only at the edge. The bulk is an open question. And along the way, we got an optimal lower tail estimate for the least singular value for the shifted Ginibre matrices. Thanks.